My guest today is Nancy Ancowitz, who is a coach specializing in career advancement and presentation skills. She's been speaking about and coaching introverts since the early 2000s. A pioneer of popular introvert literature, Nancy wrote the book Self-Promotion for Introverts, The Quiet Guide to Getting Ahead. It was a Publisher's Weekly best book. Nancy's other work has been published in the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal. Nancy helps clients, introverts and extroverts alike, develop one of the most important career building and leadership skills, influencing an audience in front of a room and one-on-one, virtually and in person. She's a thinking partner and stalwart supporter for her clients, who range from CEOs to emerging leaders in the business and creative worlds. Nancy is also a career director and adjunct instructor at New York University, where she teaches things like public speaking and business writing. Welcome, Nancy.
Hi.
I should say Nancy Ancowitz. So we have the full professional name here. quick question for you to start out with. We just heard a little bit about your background. I'm so thrilled to have you on the podcast today, the Introvert Ally.
Likewise.
Where are you from? Are you a New Yorker originally? Because your accent doesn't reveal that as being the
I am.
Origin. You are.
New Yorker. Yeah.
Interesting. Did you know that I was from there too? So we have
I did know.
You could hear my accent too. It always creeps in. So we have that in common. And you know, I always connect with New Yorkers. Just got back from there again. And there's just a natural affinity when you go back to your home, right?
Sure. I feel that even though I am home, but it's lovely.
You are home. Yeah. You are home. So Nancy, you and I met back in the beginning days when introversion really was not on the radar of many people, except for a few of us who had been educated, but I think it was 2009 when your book came out.
Yes.
Why don't we start with that? Tell us about what prompted that book, Self-Promotion for Introverts, which is a classic in the canon. What do we call it? The canon.
The canon classic. We are pioneers.
Sounds so highfalutin. Oh,
highfalutin. Well, what prompted it? Okay. I took the Myers-Briggs type indicator assessment when I was on Wall Street. I spent 12 years on Wall Street, and they just gave it to everybody at the firm where I was. And it gave context to a lot of my preferences. One-on-one meetings versus giant mosh pits of meetings, which we had plenty of. Thinking before speaking, loving building one-on-one relationships over time, being kind of private, enjoying listening more than talking, at least unless I'm passionate about a topic, low on chit-chat, I'm a deep sea diver to many an extrovert snorkeler. No offense, Jennifer. We're all the same water. In fact, I long admired your work because you're an extrovert writing for introverts. And I know that you mentioned your husband's an introvert and all that stuff. So I get it. And so that inspired me to learn more about how I can thrive as an introvert in a very extroverted corporate environment. And later on in entrepreneurial environments as well. So over the years, I pulled together tips and techniques. I had always dreamt of writing a book. And when I left Wall Street, the dream was to write a book for other introverts to help them advance in their careers based on my own experience. So that's where I was coming from.
So that's where you're coming from. And you certainly didn't jump into a natural, easy, place for an introvert, right? And also let's say back then, without revealing your age or which we could, but back when you're talking about when you were at Wall Street for a woman.
Yeah.
Right. So it was a challenge. So what do you think by having that? And by the way, the Myers-Briggs has been a real eye opener for many of us from that era. I think it really was it was the turning point, wasn't it?
It was because we didn't just take the assessment. We had training and learned about it and learned that it's not a test. It's something that it's really for self-knowledge, but also to help you get to know how to work with others. I think we often think of ourselves and what we need and what we want, and we tend to forget sometimes about the people around us, that they have different preferences. And so it really, I thought it gave a lot of depth to my communications, to my interactions, my relationship building. It was quite meaningful.
And so you took that information and you say before you did leave and move to help others and write the book, that the insights there helped you. So can you give an example of what you remember that, you know, what that did, what that, you know, that shift was for you, either in the behaviors you exhibited or?
Sure. One of my favorite bosses on Wall Street was my last boss. And she was a raving extrovert to my introvert. And just bubbly, full of life, the mayor, you know, she was sort of the mayor of the, one doesn't have a mayor in the corporate world, but you get the idea. She knew everyone, knew everything. It was just that kind of person. And I loved learning from her. I just observed and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And we got along quite well. And we had these meetings every Monday at 7:45 a.m., the entire like 30, 40 of us. And at these meetings were dense and intense and I might say dry. And one day she had to miss the meeting and I was there. And she catches me on the hall leaving the meeting. And she said, "Nancy, tell me the highlights." And I smiled, took a breath and said, "I'll catch you after my next meeting or later this afternoon." And I might have even summarized it by email. But there's no way, even if you ask me if I just saw a movie that I loved, what it was about, no way.
And because that references what you said earlier about introverts wanting to do what? What does that play to in terms of your knowledge of yourself as an introvert? You need time.
Needing time to think before speaking or acting.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah.
I needed time. I didn't apologize. It wasn't, "Sorry, my mind is blank. Boo-hoo, demote me." No, it was, I stood by myself and came up with, I think, a rather confident response that served me and served her. She didn't say, "No, damn it, I need it now." We had enough relationship. She wouldn't do that anyhow. But it was quite meaningful. And I really remembered that as something that can help other people. And so when I said no way, no how, or something like that about answering questions on the spot, now I'm going to disagree with myself a little bit and say, yes, how, and here's how. I realized that the years that I studied improvisation or comedy improvisation, but I don't consider myself like a comedian or anything like that, but it's learning to speak on the spot. So introverts can build that muscle. And I built that muscle and I've empowered and helped with the skill set of building that muscle many an introvert. It can be fun for extroverts and completely terrifying for introverts. But a fantastic skill to learn the basics, like yes and, building on what the last person said and trusting yourself, trusting others, listening, all that good stuff. So I digress a little, but go
no,
on.
You don't. I mean, but your digression is refreshing, actually.
Thank you.
And I think another one I'd throw in there is paraphrasing. To me, that's a secret sauce that introverts can use in addition, right? Particularly in networking situations where you really do not know that next question you need to ask. So you paraphrase. It buys time, right, Nancy?
We're on the same page with a lot of things, Jennifer, and this is one of them. And paraphrasing, yes. Anything to buy time. Let's say you are on a job interview or you're doing a Q&A during a presentation, a webinar, what have you, and somebody throws you a curveball, you can paraphrase what they said. So I understand your question is, how large is the average elephant on the safari, whatever it is? Yeah. And so that bought you a little time to think. And then they can say, oh, yeah, that's my question. Or no, I really wanted to know the width of their feet. So,
yes. But I love your little idea about having some tools, right? You talk about that a lot in your book and in your interviews. You've talked about tools, you know, like I had a colleague, Gene Greisman, who would say, he would call me up and may he rest in peace. He passed recently. He's a real mentor for me. And he would say, Jen, I have one comment and two questions. And so to me, that was very introvert friendly from his standpoint. Even though he wasn't necessarily introverted, but he was very organized in his communication. And so he had planned it out. And so introverts can do that too, right? So I was ready as the listener. So you have tons of examples on communication tips, right?
Indeed. It's ask about the question, paraphrase the question, say, and another favorite is, gee, and you can't say great question more than once, let's say, but you can comment on the question like, wow, fantastic question. I need to get back to you on that. And, or, so my first thought is blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to tell you the whole world of information, but I'll tell you.
One of our guests, Pat Waters, talked about not trying to overbake the idea. So, you know, and qualifying it, like you're saying, letting people know, give them, this is one point I'm going to share with you. Or you could say, this is not fully formed yet, but these are my initial thoughts, you know, like draft. So you're getting your voice in the room.
Yes. It's saying, I'm giving you my draft.
Yeah, that's a new one we just came up with, Nancy. I think
and I like not trying to overbake the idea. That's pithy.
Yeah, well, okay. So moving on then. So you got into this field and what happened? You wrote the book. I know you were doing a lot of trainings and speaking. And how did your career morph from that to being a coach? And maybe talk a little bit about the different buckets that you have. Because I know when one reads your bio, it's the length is appropriate. But I think what really strikes one is about the many areas that you you touch.
I believe that we have one life. We don't know how long it's going to be. And I want to live it to the fullest for me. So I have experienced and will experience everything that tastes good, that feels good, that contributes to other people's well-being and enriches others. And it became clearer to me that that is really what I want to do, is enrich others. And how did I figure that out? When I was on Wall Street, I hired a coach. And the coach held up the mirror for me, so to speak, and pointed out that I was burnt out. And she suggested that I take a leave of absence. And I thought it was a ridiculous idea. And I said, I can't do that. I have clients. I have deadlines. I have blah, 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 blah. And I thought about it a little more and I realized she was right. So I asked that wonderful extrovert boss for time off for 3 months. She agreed to the 3 months. That turned into 6 months, turned into 9 and 12. And then I had to make a big decision. I mostly slept during that time and also did some self-reflection. The self-reflection led me to realize that my volunteer work for a spectacular international community, it was then called the International Center of New York, which no longer exists. It was a nonprofit. I just volunteered to help people find jobs, to help them with their professional branding, to help them with their speaking skills and from different countries. And I realized I really loved that. What if I did that, started a business doing that? What would I call myself? Back then, coaches weren't really much of a thing. Executive coaches, yeah, but it was pretty, not that much. So I retooled. I decided to leave JP Morgan at the time, which nobody did. It was just so unusual, but I got all these lovely little emails and phone calls saying, gee, that's what I've always dreamt of. So, you know, I've always wanted to be it. Yeah. So that was fun. So I left. I took some courses in coaching and also wrote an article back then before the book came out for the Wall Street Journal. At the time had an online place for careers, and I submitted something despite my practically paralyzing fear of writing, despite being heading editorial departments and all that, perfectionist. So I submitted it, and a day or so later, they accepted it. That started giving me a phenomenal platform, because then agents were writing to me and publishers were writing to me, why don't you write a book? And I thought, oh my gosh, wow. And then one thing led to the next. I got affiliated with NYU through a deep, long time ago contact of mine who brought me in, basically. I wasn't looking at all. So all these pieces started coming together, and I had enough platform. As you know, as an author, you need to be able to write, to speak, and to have a following. So I started building all the following piece, and just one thing led to the next. Later on, did an article for the New York Times, have been interviewed by all the above and the same publications largely that you've been interviewed by, all the biggies. And that's phenomenal for books, you know, that publishers and agents want that. You can be a fantastic writer, but they're generally not interested unless you have a following and can speak.
Now more than ever, Nancy.
Now more than ever, right.
In fact, an editor just shared with his followers on LinkedIn that basically that they won't even look at proposals unless you have a following. So what strikes me about what you shared is that you are really demonstrating, as an introverted professional who's been successful, that you did it the introvert way. You did it in a way where you built your platform step by step. The fact that you went deep on things and you were diligent, you didn't kind of, because one might look at your resume, Nancy, as I look at it now, and one might guess that you were an extrovert. And why do I say that? Because of what your first earlier statement, when you said, I like to be involved in so many different areas, I want to get the most out of life. And not that introverts don't say that, but I hear that more from extroverts, you know, all that enthusiasm, bustling, I want to do this, I want to do that. But what I'm hearing is that you do have, that's not just the domain of extroverts, that introverts can have passion, they can have a calling like you did and go deep with it.
Yes. And the rest of that story is that I realized that I really loved what my coach did for me. It was profound. And I wanted to do that for other people. And that passion to do that, both with my NYU graduate students, I'm also affiliated with other universities, as well as my private clients, it just floats my boat. I love it. I just really love what I do. And I had a good career on Wall Street. I enjoyed it. It was analytical. So I used my mind and my creativity, but I really love what I do now. And it's just so suited for me.
And you've been doing it a while. It hasn't gotten old.
No.
It sounds like. Yeah.
I think this is a keeper. You know, it's not at all. I really love doing it and love helping people get jobs and promotions and all kinds of public speaking opportunities and helping them with that. So it's totally fun.
And you had talked about, you know, your bio too. It's interesting that you mentioned the word results at least once, that you get results. Yeah. So it's not a nice to have. So can you tell us a little bit about what kind of reaction do you get from the many students, the younger people you're dealing with now? Do you see them resonate with the term introvert? Do they see it as something to embrace?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, I wear a lot of hats, as you know, but one is I'm a career director at NYU at the Courant Institute of Mathematical Sciences in one specific program. And then I'm also, I teach at NYU in a master's program in HR, and particularly the HR students totally are very interested in who they are, who others are. And the introversion piece also resonates with the Courant students and others I work with. That, I mean, we're half the population. We could quibble about the statistics, but we're about half the population. So it's pretty relatable. Yes.
That's very cool. And I think in the larger context too, it's not so foreign an idea. They read about it. They hear about it. You hear people talking about it more. Do you notice that as well? Like, you'll be in a coffee shop and you're probably like me, you eavesdrop a little bit, or maybe extroverts do that more.
We do it too. We do it too.
I'm always struck at lunchtime how the same, I hear the same conversations no matter what city I'm in or what coffee, lunch place. Everybody's complaining about things, about their boss or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
But you hear it come up just in conversation.
Yes.
To me, a very encouraging, you know, very positive move.
Yes. And in 2009, we didn't hear it.
No, we didn't hear it. No, mm-mm. Not at all. No. So now another term that you use, and I love this as a coach and as a writer, you talk about yourself, Nancy, as a thinking partner. And that strikes me as kind of aligned with what we're trying to do in discussions on this podcast, which is really about being an ally. You know, and really speaking up when we see maybe some inequities or some bias that's crept into our organizations or and our teams, you know, to be an ally, to speak up for people. What can we learn from the term thinking partner? How do you view that role?
Sure. Thinking partner is somebody who actively listens, who takes things in, who processes them in their own way. And is a sounding board, somebody who reflects, who provides safety for the people around them. In other words, if they tell you something in confidence, it goes nowhere. Or if you ask for permission to repeat, then you can repeat. If not, not. And that ties into allyship, I think, as well, which is how can I support other people in what they need and support them in their career advancement or whatever it is. And
I love that. I love that. And that, I'm sure your coaching has helped, your coaching training and your experience has helped a lot with that. So really, communication is your jam, as we see it, right?
It's my jam. And I will also say there's a lot of experts and there are no experts.
What do you mean?
And this is something, yes, there are a lot of experts and then a lot of people say they're, you know, expert in that. But in the end of the day, you're only as expert as your ability to connect with your audience. So if you don't know your audience, you're not an expert. You didn't do the heavy lift. Like Jennifer, even on this podcast, you've obviously read my work. You've taken the time. Off camera, you were saying that you had watched some of my videos. You really came up with thoughtful questions. And you're only as good as your ability to target your audience. I think that's true in every arena. And introverts go about it differently from extroverts.
And they go about it very well, I shall say. Because what you all have taught me is to do what I, on my model, is the prepare, presence, push, and practice, right? But preparation is the ace in the hole. And I think many extroverts, because we can be very good at winging it, it doesn't mean that that's quality winging. So what we by but for me, as soon as I started getting into this work and really not just living with an introvert, but kind of studying the topic and him, of course, I realized that preparation was what made the difference. So whether it was meeting with my editor to write, you know, the next chapter and to get his feedback and to be very prepared for the very penetrating, tough questions he'd ask me. You know, or if it was going into an audience of mathematicians like you have at NYU, it was getting into their headset and kind of anticipating what they might be challenged with. So I have to give you all really the credit for that. And the point is, both of these styles are within us, aren't they, Nancy? The extrovert and introvert.
Oh, yes, yes. In fact, when you said you suggested something that through my bio, one might guess that I'm more of an extrovert. I think we're complex human beings, and I can be really outgoing, mainly with people I've known for a long time and enjoy, or in a place where I'm comfortable. But naturally, I I definitely need my quiet time to recharge, typical introvert stuff, and really am much more alive in a one-on-one interaction than in a large meeting where everybody's talking. But the exception is public speaking. So when I was writing my book, I camped out in a corporate apartment, but I kind of hid out from New York. I went to Omaha, and for the annual meeting of Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett's company, I was hoping to ask him a question during his annual meeting. And it's ridiculous because there's 30,000 some odd people who were attending.
It's famous, isn't it? It's a famous.
Yeah, it's kind of famous. Yeah. It's kind of famous. You have to line up at like 5:30 in the morning or something. And it's ridiculous. And so anyhow, I did my intel. I asked around, how do you ask him a question? Because people go year after year. And I learned that you go to the side room. Not all the other rooms are like giant, in New York terms, Madison Square Garden. Like everybody sees everybody. But there's a side room, which isn't on video. And anyhow, I went there, I lined up, I was the first in line, and I asked a question, and I asked him about introverts getting ahead in their careers. And I was really ready to be thrown out. I didn't know if he would go for it or not.
Was he there in person or was he in the other room?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, he was right and his there partner, in the room.
Okay. Charlie Munger. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. With 30,000 humans. And there were only, I don't know how many people asked questions, a few dozen, not much. So I was there, and it's on YouTube, but I mean, I'm off camera. He's on camera, he and Charlie Munger. And I asked him the question, and I was really scared. I practiced it, practice, prepare, rest up, practice, prepare. Yeah, so that's what I do. And he embraced the question and related to life as an introvert. And his story was largely around public speaking. And that he was terrified to speak up even in high school and college. Then he enrolled in a Dale Carnegie,
public, right.
Public speaking. And then he stopped payment on the check. He was so scared. So then he took $100 in cash back in those days. That's all it was. He brought it and he found people that were so scared to speak, they couldn't say their names. And then finally everybody's, I don't know, something like standing on tables. And so he built up his public speaking and he taught at universities. And now, you know, you don't have to be a billionaire investor to learn public speaking. And he suggested as early in your career as possible. And for introverts, there's a special thing here. It's such an important skill. I mean, my jam is largely career advancement. So if you want to get ahead in your career, it is a fantastic way to do that. Whether it's in front of people on Zoom, in front of people in person, it gets you to use that introvert energy to do your research, your preparation, your practice in advance. And then, you know, then you use up your social energy in front of the room, and then you can go fall asleep and read a book. Not necessarily in that order. There you go.
Because you're so well prepared.
Yeah, you're so well prepared.
Yeah, yeah. And then how about the question that many people ask you now is about, you know, virtual presentations and how does that fit or not fit with the introvert sensibility?
It's so funny. My client base is down the middle on that. Some can't stand it. And just thinking of the introverts for now, some can't stand it. They're not comfortable with it. They really want to meet in person. And others are so relieved by it and so comfortable, like me. I when I had to go back at NYU and teach in person, I was really
not so much. Yeah.
I mean, it was okay. I mean, I like it too, but there was something about I love the efficiency of being online. There's no travel. And I love that I believe fully you can have amazing rapport online. It doesn't, there's so many people I know now that I've never met in person, and I actually blur it. Like before we went on live, I think we were sort of, have we ever met in person?
I know. I've had that happen a lot. But there is also that energy people talk about in person, which is nice. I like that.
Yes.
You have some of that. Yeah, for sure.
Sure.
Nancy, many introverts still abhor the term networking, and they're told by their managers and by their coaches that they need to get out there and network. And that's how you get ahead, right? So can you talk a little bit about what you've experienced personally as an introvert and also as a coach and advisor to introverts who are rising up in their careers?
Yes, I'll start with me because you asked it personally. It absolutely feeds my soul to help people by connecting them. I absolutely love doing it. It's you meet you. I vouch for both of you. Go get a job, go get an opportunity, meet this other amazing human being and may it grow. So it feeds my soul. I just love doing it. I do it on weekends. I do it on evenings. I do it day, just all the time I'm connecting people. And often to fantastic results like jobs and whatnot. And then it's similar for my clients and my graduate students. It's not about get out of your shell if you're an introvert. It's not about that. It's coming at the world. I have strengths to offer. I have gifts to offer organizations, people. And if I keep it secret, nobody's going to know. So it's on me to get the word out and it's on me to connect with people and help, help, help. So if it's all about doing that, then instead of, I think it's icky to brag. Yeah, it is. I don't want to put anyone down. I don't want to name drop any of that stuff. It's more about what do these other people need that I can provide? Mm.
And it gives you a sense of pleasure, as I'm sure it does with a lot of people.
Absolutely.
Right? It's interesting. If you've read Adam Grant's work on working, we can also go too far with networking. So with connecting, right? Where we're not taking care of our own needs. So that's something just to be aware of. But I think that your point there is so true that we see many introverts who are successful doing that in a very low-key, very effective, influential way. Connecting people the way you have. And that helps you as well to stay in the game. Yes?
Absolutely. I'm known as a connector. Yeah. Or I don't want to talk about me so much, but one can be a super connector. Somebody who's really knows everybody and is great at putting the dots together. So yeah. And as an introvert, I go at it more like from the comfort of my keyboard. As opposed to going into lots of group meetings, which are not mainly my thing, unless, again, I'm the speaker or on a panel or, you know, facilitating a panel.
Yes. From the comfort of your keyboard. That's a takeaway for sure.
Yeah.
I love
Thank
it.
Thank you.
That alliteration. Yeah, Nancy. So listen, we could be talking for hours, I'm sure. But then you will need even more of a nap. Yeah. So I want to be respectful of your time. This is one of the reasons I do the podcast, to be able to connect with my colleagues who I have so much respect for, so that we can share your gifts, which I think people got a glimpse today of Nancy Ancowitz and all that you have to offer and all your experience and your commitment to really rising everybody up. Not just introverts and extroverts. So where can folks find you to learn more about your world and what you can support them with?
NancyAncowitz.com, NANCY, and then Ancowitz. You probably will have it somewhere on
there. Yeah, we'll have it in the show notes, but it doesn't hurt to have that.
So they can find my information there. I'm also on LinkedIn. I'm not too active on the other social media, but those are two good ways.
But we can get you. We can find you.
Yeah.
Nancy, thank you for just a glorious conversation. It's been, a real aid, I think, to anyone who wants to be an ally to introverts and who also wants to develop themselves. So thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. With pleasure.
That wraps up another episode of the Introvert Ally Podcast. Thanks so much for listening. If you found value from our podcast, we'd love you to subscribe, rate, and review us on your favorite platform. Also, please do share it with others. Thanks, and I'll see you next time.